2 months, many people, after, you know, it's something that is getting discussed a lot, but there is not many companies, many big applications with Flink yet that are popular. So when Gianmario asked me to do a talk on Flink, I decided to, okay, I will basically explain Flink, but I want to explain why Flink is getting so much hype, it's getting so much interest from, you know, from companies and developers. So the first part will be a brief introduction to Flink in itself, and the second part will be the story, narration of what is machine learning today on Flink. Basically, I would like to explain to who among you is evaluating Flink or is thinking about, you know, go to his boss and say, we should think of Flink for our application. I would like to explain to those people if Flink is the right tool and what is available to machine learning on Flink, so that you don't have to do scouting from scratch. Also, it's not a commercial talk. My company works with Flink, but I would like to explain the stuff that's happening on Flink for what it is. And so, no bad words, no commercial ideas, and weird stuff like machine intelligence, or it's a bit like a brain that, you know, ruining the machine learning world with fake hype. Okay, why you should look at Flink and say this is cool? Basically because it's one of the few major engines that is production ready, so you can use it right now. That is serving first. What is serving first? Serving first means that the computation is modeled as a streaming. And you say, so it's a streaming engine. No, because you have a batch mode, similar to the batch mode of Spark, where the batch is considered a streaming with an end. It's a special case of a streaming. So Flink works one element at a time because it's a streaming. And this is the new trend. All the new frameworks that are getting traction that I mentioned before in the last talk are working this way. So, also, it's low latency, so it's better Spark on this particular feature. And it's the most important reason that lead people to choose Flink or Spark. You don't have to go on Flink right now if you don't have this requirement. Also, it's the only measure of engine that allows a high level of fault tolerance and resilience without impacting performances and without losing data. Also, it can scale because, for example, Apache Storm can do all of this, but it is slow. Well, those are problems with fault tolerance, but okay. So, this is a general architecture of Flink. If you know Spark, it's pretty much the same concept. You have a runtime that takes a program written in the API. In this case, we are talking about Java and Scala, and Python is a work in progress. We have an API for streaming, an API for batch. You write your own programs, you send it to the runtime that takes the role of web received layer. And we have an underlying layer of execution. You can run Flink on your local machine, on Yarn, Mesos support is coming, or other systems in cloud. On top of the API, we have many libraries, even more than that. What is of interest for us is FlinkML, that is the machine learning library. Also, the CIP may be of interest for, you know, if you work with data, a CIP is a good tool to have so you don't have to write your own complex queries by yourself. And also, Jelly, that is still rather young and not production ready, that does graph processing. It's the equivalent of GraphX in Spark. Flink has many integrations and connectors to databases and the external system. Obviously, it is integrated with Kafka because streaming is the leading element of all the design of Flink, so Kafka is a requirement today if you want to file for good streaming, but also Flume and Content View. You have Flink on a loop that for somewhere based on has the overload. Where a loop is on top, and I don't know why. And so on. Okay. This is a representation of a Flink cluster where we have the client, that is what you execute on your local machine, for example. And you define a program like a graph. We saw the DAG in Flink, it is called dataflow, but pretty much the same concept. It gets compiled, it gets optimized in the client, and this is a big difference with Spark. You can take this program and actually serialize it like a proper graph in Spark. I don't know if in the newer version something changed, but it's not really a graph like your like a data structure. It's more a flow of computation. You can't really do this thing. So you get optimization on the client. You send your job, your program, to the job manager, and this is the leading node of the cluster and the interface of the user. This node sends the job to split the job in many tasks, parallelizing it, substituting it. And you have many task managers, ideally one for every machine in your cluster, that coordinates over the network to do their task, they process data and exchange data when they need to, for example, do a join. Or something like that. You have the concept of a task slot. Task slot is the way Flink represents resources. So you can run multiple jobs with you know, defining the upper limit with the number of task slots. The underlying layer, the communication layer, is ACCA, that is a Scala framework to exactly this. They call it a toolkit to develop distributed systems. Okay. I mentioned the data flow. It's pretty much what we saw in Spark because the idea behind it is pretty much the same. You have a collection. You have a source that is represented as a collection. You define a series of transformations, and then you have a sink where you put your data. When you compile the graph, the job manager translates the graph to a distributed computation. So you have two different machines that work together, they exchange data, and in the end, they put the data in the same sink because a job can have multiple sinks, but in this case there is only one. And this thing looks a lot like Spark, and even the API looks a lot like Spark. And so the first part you might think, if you come from Spark, it's pretty much okay. I did the same stuff on Spark. They have the same name. It's all the same. So the the lower layers should be pretty much the same. Actually, no. Flink works in a very different way, because here you have a flow of transformation, and but it's not applied on a batch, on a collection. It's applied one element at a time. And when you have this kind of operations, for example, a join, every operator collects, every node collects some data in Windows if we are in string, or with their own logic, if we are in batch, to do the joining and produce the result. Okay. All clear now? Okay. Let's talk about machine learning on Flink. Because it's a, if you come from Spark, you are a bit spoiled, because you have all the work working on Spark, and you have a lot of stuff, many libraries, many tools. Everything you want to do probably is already implemented. Usually the quality is not that good, but that's another problem. In Flink, it is rather different, because it's still small, and while many big companies are working on it, machine learning is still in an early phase. Okay, before we explain the difference between a parallel and distributed, and I believe Flink is already a really good tool when you need to work in parallel, where parallel means machine learning tasks that are easy to parallelize. What I mean, for example, hyperparameterizations, or any kind of meta-modeling, or maybe evaluation. Evaluation can be parallelized. You can replicate your static model on many, many nodes, and the Flink is fast as hell, and it's a good option to do that on Flink instead of Spark, because if you want to evaluate a dozen of models in 50 milliseconds, the micro batch of Spark is not an option, because it's not streaming. On the other side, when you need to do learning, you need to rewrite your algorithms, because distributed learning is not the same, and distributed optimization is not the same as local learning. So there is a lot of work to do if you want to implement your customized algorithms. And what is already here is what I will talk about in the next 20 minutes. So let's start with evaluation on Flink. This is a high-level description of what you need to do in a schematic way to evaluate the model on Flink. It's the classical pipeline. You have your sources of data, you join them and prepare them, extract your data, you evaluate your models, you format the output the way you like, and then you output the result. This is the same as you will do on your local machine. This is easy to write on Flink. I won't show code today, but you can imagine that every section of this pipeline is what is called an operator on Flink. That is basically a transformation function. The cool part of Flink over Spark, I would say, is that it's easy to compose and reuse, and I don't want to rewrite all my data preparation on many projects that need the same data for different models. So I can write this once and compose easily with the others. This can be done on Spark clearly, but it's somewhat more complex and hacky, in my opinion at least. To work better on these common use cases, I developed what is this library that is called Flink Man, that basically abstracts away part of the data preparation, the evaluation, and the post processing. So you just define you pick some strategies for how to handle null values or other things like that. You give the operator a model, clearly in the MML, as the name implies, and it handles the rest. Okay, let's come to learning on Flink. I believe that right now, in the early phase of Flink, the community is focusing on what is really needed on a big data environment. Because many people believe that going big data means going faster. Usually it's not the case. Usually big data means slower. It is faster only when you have a lot of data. So for most machine learning applications, a big single machine is better than a distributed algorithm with dozens of machines. And also, as I said, working on a distributed environment takes more time, and so you can't fail cheaply in the way we mean that. I mean, if you need to implement your algorithm on a distributed system, and you are not an experienced machine learning engineer, it takes time. It takes a lot of time. While on a local machine, you can write in an unoptimized version and be ready in some days. Okay. You can't see anything here because it's too crowded, but this is the big data landscape of the current year. And most of the tools I mentioned and that I will mention later are not even here. I'm showing you this because it is needed to explain why Flink is machine learning on Flink is so fragmented, because the whole ecosystem is fragmented. If you come from Spark, you are spoiled again, because Spark is the big player, is the most it's the most important framework to work with today, but for other kind of tools, there is not a dominant engine or dominant product. And the same could be said for machine learning. There is not a leading machine learning library on big data. We have many big players, Mout, H2O, let's see what they mentioned here. It's impossible to understand anything. Okay, then there's TensorFlow, yeah, you have one of those for deep learning, Torch, and so on. And this is a problem because, if you have a machine learning library, you can adapt it to Flink with some effort, like they did with the H2O that is integrated in Spark. And we are good. But right now, there is not an obvious option that we say, okay, they have the algorithms, we integrate them with Flink, and we have a lot of stuff that is running on Flink easily. And so I would like to present the actual options. And clearly, the first one is FlinkML, that is the out of the box library that comes with the Flink. And it's the equivalent of SparkML. Let's say that it has the same algorithms and the same quality of Spark 1.2. So missing a lot of stuff, but you have all the workloads algorithms you need, the ILS for recommending system, linear regression, logistic regression, and so on. Kappa means, k-means, this is still in development, and I'm part of the development as a contributor. The good part is that you have the basic algorithms that work well in big data, but you are implementing them while there are many libraries that already have the same algorithms, and you don't have any framework for persistence. So it's really hard to take your models from Flink or to put your models on Flink. That's the reason why I did the Flink Debian map in the first place. Another interesting tool is the Samsara, that is a part of Apache Mount. It's a linear algebra framework that defines their algorithms, its algorithms, in terms of a set of primitives that are operational matrices. So you have, for example, SQD expressed in terms of multiplications, additions, and so on. And those primitives are implemented on different runners like Spark, Flink, Google Dataflow, Hadoop, and local version. Also Apache Apex. And this is cool because it's really portable. All the updates they produce are available on Flink, because there are those primitives implemented in Flink. The bad part is that it's only for linear algebra. And clearly this is not enough for many applications. You can do recommender, you can do SVD, but nothing matters. Another cool project is Apache Samoa, that comes from the same guys you may know for Wake Up. Who knows Wake Up? Okay. They developed a framework called MOA, Massive Online Analysis, that was a streaming engine that runs on a single machine to do online learning. Samoa is only for online learning, and they have a nice collection of algorithms. Their focus is mostly academic, but they are slowly going toward the industry, but it's definitely not production ready. They missed, for example, the Kafka connector until a few months ago. So they wanted to do streaming, but they could read the data only from static files on HDFS for a local system. Clearly, this was part of some confusion inside the community. It is really good because the collection of algorithms is really well written. They have a theoretical work behind many algorithms that they implemented for the first time in a distributed environment, at least to my knowledge. The bad part is that it's not ready. Okay, and these are all the options that you could download from the internet and run on Flink without not more than a couple hours of effort. But many of you probably expect much more from a framework that is getting more and more popular. So I would like, I should talk about what is coming next, that is way bigger than what is actually here. Because many projects are starting right now because of self-traction. And so the most important, I believe, is Apache Beam. Well, Apache Beam is a project that is not related to machine learning. It's an API developed by Google in the first place and then released as open source that allows the user to write streaming programs and also batch programs in terms of streaming the same concept as before with a unified API. So you write the same programs for streaming a batch, sort of, and it's really well designed. You have a separation of concerns. But the very important thing to us is that it's platform agnostic. So you write your own programs in Beam, and you can run them on Spark, on Flink, on Google Dataflow, and Apex, and many others. Your pump, and many others will come. What does this mean? It means that whatever you write on Beam is portable and will be portable for systems that don't even exist right now. And this is big because if this project takes traction, this is going to change the whole big data industry because you know, you can see the benefit of not being locked in on the platform you are working right now. For example, to export your jobs from a framework to another, there are some web tools that are bundled. And this way, this is the clean way to do it. And if you want to do machine learning, this is the right way. Because you can write your logic and ignore the runner. You can write your version of, I don't know, a logistic regression that was an optimization function, and the optimization function is then implemented in a custom version for every runner. The other cool feature of Beam is that it's extensible, so you can write new functions like a custom version of a gradient descent directly in Flink or Spark to get better performances. And BeamML is the proposed project for this. It's not yet started, it's just a discussion going on. But give attention to this project because, to my knowledge, this is the best way to machine learning on big data. It won't come out before many years, maybe, but it will be. I hope so, because then it becomes a problem for machine learning engineers like me. okay, some developments will come from FlinkML, because clearly it has its own contributors. And there is a roadmap for more algorithms. And I believe the most important part is the online learning framework to do what Samoa does, but directly on Flink. And clearly, I would like to see this evaluation framework or a pipeline package to do evaluation in a clean way without implementing every time the same logic. Okay, this is a project that I think none of you knows. No, and how many of you have heard of Proteus? Okay, this is a huge project financed by the European Union. Started like a month ago. They have the money. They have the people. Many of them come from Flink, others are from German universities and Spanish universities. And there are many Greeks, I don't know why. Greeks like Flink a lot. And this is basically someone on steroids. So you put academics to write a framework that redefines its own computational model. So you don't use the Flink data flow. They have their own version. And it used here in Italy at the conference, I don't remember the name, on the Gappa Lake.
ICM,
okay, I wasn't sure. Okay, that is a big conference. And they will have a talk there presenting process. Okay, and these were the options of machine learning right now and the future of Flink. I would like to spend some words on what my company does, not only because it is an advertisement, but also because we are really interested in the topic of fast data and machine learning on fast data, and our philosophy may be interesting for people to imagine new products. First of all, what we do is a fast data distribution, a collection of open source softwares to do fast data applications. We have Flink, obviously, Cassandra, that is a database, Alaxio, that is a file system, Zeppelin to do data visualization and write some programs on Flink, and obviously Kafka. And we sell this distribution to companies that want to, you know, to do fast data, process huge volumes of data in real time. And we believe this is the next big thing in the industry. What we did until now, on Flink at least, this is the work of a few months. We are a rather young company, startup. We developed the Cassandra connector to integrate with Cassandra. We developed some extensions to the Scala API of Flink, because they were ugly compared to Spark. We made some syntax sugar. I worked with on Flink ML to implement to develop a linear algebra framework. Complex analytics in real time where before was impossible, or impossible at least for small companies where small means smaller than Google and Yahoo, so, and LinkedIn. These tools allow programmers and small companies to achieve a degree of performance that enable new applications. New applications means that yesterday it was unthinkable to deploy to deploy 50 models to be evaluated for every request on a website. You click on a page, you want to evaluate a model that is not an IIS model or something fast like that, but you may imagine deep learning models or linear models if you like. And you can do that with this kind of performances. It won't be necessarily Flink, it will be its successor, but this is the way we are going. And I think it's important to begin thinking about it right now, because it's already at hand. We just need to know it is possible. Thank you, everybody. Okay.
Thank you, Ryan.
Thank you very much.
Okay, that's a question. I have seen you developed the driver for Cassandra.
Yeah, it wasn't me.
Yeah, the company. The architecture similar to Spark, so this in Spark is just to have one Spark node on each Cassandra, in order to retrieve just the data of that node. I was wondering if
I know there were problems like that, but I didn't work on that, so I can't.